Welcome to the second session of Aleksanteri Alumni Talks. This is a series of seminars where we are having a chance to hear alumni of our Visiting Fellows program tell us about their recent research. So thank you all for joining. Nice to see you. My name is Anna Korhonen. I'm head of international affairs here at the Aleksanteri Institute. And today we are very happy to have Juraj Buzalka from Comenius University in Bratislava to join us and share some highlights of his recently completed research. And his today's title is Counter-Enlightenment, Populism in Post-Socialist European Union, Village-fascists in Slovakia. And Juraj is an associate professor in social anthropology, and he has worked thoroughly on themes like anthropology of political movements, nationalism, populism, politics of memory, politics and religion, and generally social transformations in Eastern Central Europe. And he has also just recently published a book related to this topic, or today's talk is based on the book, rather. The title of the book is A Cultural Economy of Protest in Post-Socialist European Union, Village Fascists and Their Rivals. And Juraj was a visiting fellow at the Aleksanteri Institute in 2009, so quite some time ago, but it's nice to see you now. A final note that, as you saw, we are recording now, but we are only recording Juraj's talk, so then not the discussion, so only the talk will be recorded. Okay, that's all from me now, and Juraj, now please, the floor is yours.
Hello, everyone. Thank you very much for this kind introduction. I'm very pleased to be back in Helsinki, even only virtually. I have very vivid memories of meetings and discussions around the Institute. And I'm very honored, of course, to have a chance to talk to you after I kind of moved on with my work since I was visiting long time ago. But what I would like to talk about today, I have been thinking a lot about from which perspective to approach the material I would like to share. And the best idea I had was to kind of tell you about how did I come to the topic and how did I approach it in the end. So I would like to talk about 20-25 minutes, then we will have some pictures to give you a flavor of what the topic is about, and then I'm really looking forward to hear Katalin's comments and eventually your questions. So, Counter-Enlightenment populism. This was the theme we agreed upon, and thank you, Anna, for reminding me about the importance of this particular theme. My work on radical politics, or on populism rather, on populism than radical politics, has been long lasting. Somehow I devoted significant part of my previous book to populism in Poland, and I focus especially on the relationships between populism and religion, basically taking religion as one of the sources of particular kind of populism. And this has stayed with me, only that I kind of moved to another theme, and I kind of knew, and everybody knew, I think, that it's about the economy. And that was a popular sentence made widely known by Bill Clinton when he entered his office, U.S. president. So, but I didn't know how to approach it. So I was with religion, and I kind of looked for inspiration, how to grasp it from economic perspective. And actually this religious background or this research on religion and populism helped me very much of how to discuss it. So this is just to give you an idea about how did I begin thinking about the topic, and it has taken me some 10 or so years to come up with a conclusion in a form of a book. Of course, it's a book, it should be finished, but of course everyone knows that it's just the working progress. After one finishes his or her work, it's just another beginning. So this is my impression too. Okay, so what's the general aim, how to approach populism and especially its radical version? This village fascism is my term I looked for a while, and it exactly characterizes why I use it as a concept. Actually, it's very important to connect the village with fascism in this part of Europe and in the case of Slovakia in particular. So I would like, or I have been moving between two kind of wide fields of politics, how to approach politics. One can be related to representations and to symbolic actions, rituals, and so on. And the other one is more related to material economy. It's a kind of political economy of protest, let's say. And I was dissatisfied somehow with either or approach. So I of course, this is a banal thing that you have to combine. Yeah, of course. But somehow you always end up in approaching one or the other more. So I tried to set up a kind of, I'm not saying the middle way, but somehow combining these things in a new synthesis, and I was looking for inspirations elsewhere, and came up with this idea of cultural economy of protest. Somehow connected the culture and representations with material background and with kind of real forces, let's say, with the technological changes and world system, if you wish. Okay. World system theory. And I will come to this later, just to tell you about the current state of affairs. So usually we approach this populism from conventional perspective, political sciences, anthropology, sociologists, as some kind of populist moment. There are even waves of populism called upon. So this work is not about this. This is not touching upon the current temporary victory of Donald Trump or Brexit in a consequence of refugee crisis and economic crisis and pandemic crisis. So this has been here for a while. And I understand that there is something very global that is universally valid for every and each populist case. But somehow after the economic crisis in 2008 and after the increasing popularity of, let's say, this kind of straight critics of neoliberalism and the market, I began to think that, okay, that's productive. Everyone is doing that, but perhaps we should go back to, let's say, legacies of particular kinds of populism. Or let's say look deeper into the past. And this has been my topic for a while. So I would like to complement this general global perspectives that derive their the major force of populist reaction is actually the market transformation and especially the liberal globalization. And I will tell you what kind of perspective did I use. And it actually comes to the theme of village fascists. So when I looked at the legacy of transformations in East Central Europe and in Slovakia in particular, obviously the most important transformation of the 20th century was the one related to state socialism. Why? Especially because this was the time, not the market global time, globalization period, But this was the time, in the case of Slovakia, it was happening over two generations in the middle of the 20th century, when the society became industrial while leaving behind its agrarian roots, but or its agrarian past. And I think this is much more essential transformation from this kind of legacy perspective than, let's say, the additional deep transformation that was coming after the period of revolutions in 1989. So my initial idea was kind of think further to the past and connect the current, let's say, vitality of populism and its radical version I call village fascism with all the legacies of transformations or all the elements, items to compose of this radical politics. And I will hopefully explain in more detail what do I mean by this. I have plenty of I have got plenty of inspirations, but major works I would like to mention are basically the three of them. Currently very popular Karl Polanyi, economic historian who now is widely used, but I referred to his work already in my first book in 2007. And actually his masterwork is a work, Great Transformation. And basically the general idea for the political movement says that that because there is a market transformation, the originally embedded social conditions or the setting, community setting, is frightened or is kind of disembedded by the impersonal forces of the market, and this is creating, and basically the impersonal bigger forces from outside of these embedded circles is creating a counter movement. And this counter movement can have a form of fascism, even can be a reactionary radical anti-modernist movement against the forces of the market, which was the case of the Nazi Germany. And or it can have a form of a milder or more progressive socialist or social democratic transformation, as was the case of the welfare states of the West. The case about the East is still unsolved, and I'm not a theoretician and nor the expert on Polanyi. I'm not about to discuss it here, but I think there was something special on socialist transformations. And obviously you can look at the socialist transformation as a counter movement of a kind, but I would stress that there is some genuine autochthonous origin of protest movement, exactly because it was state socialist, not even in a larger scale. You can see it reacted to the capitalist, let's say, world system and its historical development, but somehow I would not discuss this. I would stress that this original modernity after the World War II in Eastern Europe brought some very specific resources for contemporary populism and its radical forms. So the legacy of transformation matters, and the wide picture is Polanyi and the Great Transformation that might be related to material economy and to great transformations. My point is that it was the transformation of the socialist kind that was followed by the capitalist transformation of the 1990s, but it was a cumulative change, not the change in an opposite direction. That would be my argument. But we have to look first at the socialist modernity, at the industrialization of the specific industrialization of the state socialist period, about how peasants became workers and how much socialist economy was connected to the former agrarian past. I mean, the people's economy, and this is the second person I would like to mention here, who was a major inspiration for my approach, is Steven Goodman, is an economic anthropologist whom I have had the chance to meet several times over 10 or so years. And actually, he has a very original cultural economy perspective. He worked on Latin American countries, and he began his work on research about the house and house economy. He has never worked on socialist Europe or state socialism, so I kind of borrowed his theories, especially about his perspective on the dialectics between the market and the community, to be applied for the post-socialist setting. Only one point, because we can go on with referring to Goodman's work. I was particularly influenced or inspired by his treating of these dialectics between community and market as interconnected areas. And as he is not a determinist, he's not saying that there is something, free market economists or liberal economists or Marxist political economists saying there is no kind of basis of the basis. This is all the markets are human creatures. And as the markets are destroying communities, that's what he was saying, or threatening their appearances by loan in the financial system or by disenfranchising certain populations, so the societies are able and capable to embed them in a way. So he's having a more kind of dialectical perspective on economy. So I was dissatisfied with the general idea that a very popular perspective today, that actually there is a neoliberal market and it all is going to the hell. Basically that there is no end and we have to finish because there is a destruction coming, and somehow there is a teleology in these arguments, that this is so much fascism, more, it's like the Jehovah's Witnesses, like suddenly there is an end of the world and it's not coming. So I was, there was one thing. And the second, and this is the last point I would like to make, and the last person I would like to mention, a great inspiration for me, is an American anthropologist, Doug Holmes, with whom I had a chance to work for several years. And he wrote a very seminal book. And this book I read when I was finishing my master at Sussex University in 2000, in the year 2000. And actually I was impressed by how little attention it received when it was first published. And of course, now Doug Holmes is a very respected anthropologist and a specialist on fascism in Europe, especially. He worked on Northern Italy and in London and in various places. Now he's focusing on economy and central banks. But back then he was developing a concept of integralism and of integral Europe. And this kind of connects the community ideas, socialist redistribution and the market, as socialist redistribution and the state and the market economy and the global market as impersonal versus the community. That this is what I was trying to discuss. And actually, integralism is a sort of counter-enlightenment movement that is very modern. We think it's connected to the past, so we tend to see it in a dichotomy of modern and traditional. But this is very truly modern and very European in a way. That's what Doug Holmes wrote in 2000, and of course later as well. But this is a long tradition of European counter-enlightenment that we have to take into account. That is even embedded within the foundational myths and policies of the European Union, that we tend to forget about all these legacies of Europe as a romantic project, if you wish. And you can go whenever you go from agrarian ideals and preservation of cultural landscape through particular valuation of local cultures and regional cultures that can be, of course, very nice and cosmopolitan, but can be also very xenophobic. Or you can have subsidiarity topics with the Catholic social talk and so on. The particular kind of connection that the Europe itself is not only this modern progressive enlightenment ideal that we, especially middle-class academics, liberal leftist academics are used to think, but it's also quite the opposite. It's also the seedbed of fascism, or it has been or used to be in the past. That's why it is very important. How do you interpret this legacy? And actually, he was pointing out, Doug Holmes, that this integralism is an essential element in European culture, and it's feeding basically since Romanticism via nationalism, fascism. It has been feeding the Counter-Enlightenment movement. He got inspiration from, of course, from later Isaiah Berlin, a great liberal thinker and a philosopher, for his concept. So I used Doug Holmes' integralism to characterize these guys in Eastern Europe and especially in Slovakia as village fascists. And these village fascists, and this comes, here comes the end of my entree. Why they are village fascists? Because Slovakia, now I go lower, one level lower, because to a nation case situation. My book intended to be wider in comparison, but somehow I realized that I cannot write a book easily and to be equally engaged with all the nation state settings. It was about the Visegrad countries. But of course, there are significant differences between them, although I still hold that there are this is one region and we have to approach it as culturally similar. But then comes the point about what the political economy sometimes forgets about, or this kind of straightforward derivation of the counter movement from the global market or from as a defense. Actually, these guys are defending themselves locally by using national and local resources. So you need the symbolic stuff that you defend your with. And my point is that nationalism is not only reactionary, not only integralist, but it can be also very progressive nation building behind. And I think in Scandinavia, you know a lot about it, that it's also important. How do you narrate and what kind of populism the political elites use for mobilizing people? And I'm just saying that as you do the reactionarism, as you do the integralism, as you mobilize the romantic and anti-modernist perspective, you can do equally well the progressive tradition, if there is something progressive in that tradition. And this is my argument about Slovakia. I use the example of the current president, Zuzana Čaputová, who is a populist in my perspective, but she is a genuine example of this kind of progressive populist who really uses exactly the same material like the reactionaries, but putting it in a different interpretation. This is also the connection between integralism and reactionarism on the Europe-wide scale. Okay, so village fascists are village fascists because they consider country as a source of their pride. The power resides in the country. They believe this is the true society, the integral whole, where we all live in the natural conditions. And Brussels, cosmopolitan cities, global capitals, foreign powers, they are just kind of destroying our core organic communities. So what's so special on this village fascism? You have these guys elsewhere in the world, including Finland, but what is so special here in post-socialist Europe is exactly the way how they mobilize what I call economic memories. That this is not about ethnicity, this is not only about religion, this is all is here. Like you can have anti-Muslim attitudes, you can have ardent nationalism, you can have strong xenophobia and LGBT, anti-LGBT mobilizations, but this is economy as a component or as a community understanding and practice of these people. And this originates in socialism. It's not only representation, as some people would say, that you have the truly modern neoliberal present where these people are frustrated at their workforce and they look for the security in the country and have some pagan or Christian or whatever fundamentalist practices. I'm saying this is not just that, it's also about social relations, not only about representations. And these social relations were set up by the particular transformation of state socialism that was different to capitalist transformation. This embedment in socialism was different than it's in capitalism by the market. But there was a sort of disembedment and a re-embedment in a Polanyian sense. So you had a kind of what I call post-peasant practices and representations that were truly socialist. You didn't have a market. You had a particular community building.
There are several open windows. Okay, so this is the final word I would like to say. There is a specific combination of material economy and representation that is coming from the socialist transformations that actually populists today are reviving as a politics of memory. And I'm arguing that this is connected with popular economy, big transformations, not with socialist ideology, not necessarily, but it's about the everyday experiences under socialism, let's say 1970s and 1980s, and how it is revived by populists today. So it does matter what kind of economic memories these populists are reviving. And basically, a lot of socially secure economies are related to, or social mobilizations today are related to nostalgia for socialism, but not as an ideological system, but rather as an unnecessary product of that system. Basically, about the informal economy, about the role of kinship necessary to survive, about the blood, about what we know in post-Soviet Russia as blood, or about the free time and fooling around and all that kind of material economy related practices and representations. So this would be my argument that actually populists and radical populists, these are the village fascists, because socialism was post-peasant. It was not modern as they presented, or it was modern, but modern in its own way. And that modern way really reinvented this kind of rural representations and importance of the country, even though it was heavily, openly modernist and anti-rustical and whatever. But in effect, it worked in this way, and the populists are kind of exploiting this. So I would finish here, and we can perhaps look for some pictures and then open the discussion. So I would like to ask our colleague to share some of them I have, and I can tell you. So this is one of the cartoons I found. It's this kind of critique of the hypocrisies of the church and the fascists. There were many scandals in Slovakia about this. It's just one of the many pictures I collected. And there is, of course, in Slovak context, there is a very strong connection between the legacy of the first Slovak Republic from the World War II period that was independent under Nazi tutelage and it was an ally of Nazi Germany, and the contemporary politics of memory of the fascists. And you will see further in the next picture, perhaps, or in another picture. This is a common picture elsewhere. This is how these reactionaries look the Europe, look at Europe, how is it kind of feeding its own enemy. We can go further. Next picture. perhaps this is very much related to my first point. This is the this is how the fascists. This is very much reminiscent of the World War II imaginary, how the propaganda, the fascist Slovak state, was presented. And it's, of course, the hills, the coat of arms, eagle, and especially, that is very essential, the fall costume that is very popular and has been popular even under socialism. There is a paradox that actually socialist urban classes and university-educated people were cultivating all this folklore movement. We can go further. So these are the ordinary members of the Green Party, as we call it, because the fascists in Slovakia, they entered parliament, they have like 8% of the support, more or less. And this is a joke about them somehow. What the country, that the party of the, that the Green Party, or the how the country is, so is the Green Party, I would say. But it's a joke, but these are the real members. It's taken from internet. We can go further. And they are very much based in rural areas, and they very much, the vote, electoral base of this of this party is in the countryside. So this is one of the billboards they were showing. So we wish you a merry traditional Christmas, while the European Union will not forbid it. So that somehow, why it's not going to be closed by the EU, so enjoy traditional Christmas. We can go further. So how is it connected with imaginary? These are just other guys with a kind of kitschy lyrics. So it's from the internet too. We can go further, just to have a flavor about the people. And this is an interesting picture. So you can see it's not about the modernity of the traditionalism of the fascists versus the modernity of the state. This was taken, I took it personally from the webpage of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. Actually, I was myself impressed. I know this region because I grew up not far away from there. And it's really beautiful. But I never seen in my life, in my village, people dressed like this. So we were quite modern, I would say. But, you know, our Bratislava people, perhaps in the diplomatic jargon, they like to present Slovakia like this. So it's from the Ministry of Affairs webpage. It's beautiful Slovakia, you see. We can go further. The national, the folk dresses. This is just I took from another webpage. No, this is the newspaper of the fascists. And actually, it's a new topic. This is a very important point would like to make. This is how they connect themselves to Europe. We think that they are anti-European, but transnational alliance of fascists is very important too. And one of the key elements or key symbolic topics that connects them is anti-Islamism. And this is the Battle of Vienna commemoration, where the Christian kings defeated the Ottomans, who then left, in a consequence, left the Danube Basin. So it's very important, memorable event for all the states in the area, Austria, Hungary, and all the other neighboring countries, because it was the beginning of the new era in the region after the withdrawal of the Ottomans. And this is the funny thing, because the fascists didn't care about these topics, and they didn't care about Europe very much. But increasingly over the years, they have been contacting their fellow fascists all around the region, and were sending greeting letters and supporting their causes. Even I know the Slovak fascist Marian Kotleba, when he was a governor of the Banská Bystrica County, which is the Slovak National Uprising Against Fascism, a memorable country. And even there, fascists won as a governor. He sent a greetings even to the Ukrainian president, who was fleeing to Russia, against whom the revolution was organized. I forgot his name now. And also, he was sending greetings to Viktor Orban for erecting defense against the refugees and so on and so on. So we can go further. So this anti-Muslim or anti-Oriental trope is extremely important among the fascists. This is the former prime minister of Slovakia, Peter Pellegrini, with an Italian name, as you can hear, who is now the leader of the opposition. And he likes to wear full dresses. That's something, I don't know how can he wear that. It's nice, I like it too. My mother even had some in her wardrobe. She never wore since she was married. She married in the folk dress, as she told me. But I never seen people wearing these dresses on regular basis, but especially urban people like this. And fascists like it too. So that's another rustical connection. We can go further if there is something. This is one of the demonstrations of the party, of the fascist party. Slovakia is not Africa. It's just one of the examples of activism. They are very active. They are basically doing politics that has been forgotten by mainstream parties. This is part of their success because they actually go to the people. They visit places that have not seen high-level politicians, I don't know, never ever perhaps, remote villages, go to folklore festivals, and so on and so on. Very active people on anti-abortion marshes and so on and so on. So very connected to some church circles, fundamental and so on. I think this is the end. No, there is something more. Oh, this is important. Reminding of the. This is actually now. My friend just photographed this next to the main road. This is a billboard near Ružomberok, which is in northern Slovakia, and it's. You cannot imagine if this happens to Adolf Hitler or something in Germany, what would this cause? But this is basically a drawing of Josef Tiso, who was hanged as a war criminal after the World War II. He was a Catholic priest and the president of the Slovak Republic during the 1939 and 1945. And actually, in the end of his presidency, there was a civil war. And thanks to this civil war, actually, Slovakia was not the defeated country in the World War II. And the Slovak national uprising actually was against fascism. So it was calling for the re-emergence or re-installation of Czechoslovakia. So basically, these guys were sent to prisons and emigration, and some of them were hanged, who represented the fascist regime. And again, there is a rustical image. It's very much connected to these folklore representations. And this is one of the typical romantic pictures commemorating the World War II period. But I would say this is not only this legacy of the previous regime, of the fascist regime that preceded the communist regime, but it's much more about what is in the picture. Yeah, there is this beautiful harmonic setup, pine trees, people in folk dresses, very healthy, happily, morally, whatever, beautiful. So it's a kitsch, it's a national kitsch that fascists are using. And I think this is the final picture I wanted to share with you. And this is the end of my talk.